Okay. Okay, so like on a scale of 1 to 10, difficulty-wise, this problem is like a 3, okay? Because it factors. You don't need a quadratic formula for this one. So first of all, does it open up or down? How do you know? Yeah, the number in front here is 1, and that's greater than 0. So we know that this thing opens up. All right, so it's going to look like a parabola, right? A U-shaped opening up. Vertex, well, we just need to compute negative b divided by 2a. So for us, what is that going to be? I'm going to even put negative, negative 6, right? Because that's negative b means negative, negative 6 over 2 times 1. So 6 over 2 is 3. And then what do you do with that 3? Plug it into the function itself. So now plug 3 in here, so you get 9 minus 18 minus 7. So 3 went here and 3 went here. Negative 16?
Yeah.
So that means your vertex is a point on your graph, 3, negative 16. Now for step 3, you do a quick sketch. So you're just going to try and plot this vertex. So you go to the right 3 and down 16. Really doesn't matter. What matters is that it's below the x-axis. And our parabola opens up, right? So from this point, it should go up on the left and up on the right, which tells us what? We have two x-intercepts. So the whole point of this quick sketch is just to be able to identify we're going to have two x-intercepts. So step 4 is actually worth us doing. So how do we find the x-intercepts? Set that equal to 0 and solve. And normally at this stage, you either factor or use the quadratic formula. So I'm going to factor. The left side is x minus 7, x plus 1 equals 0. So that's when you would do that thing like this. Negative 7, negative 6, what two numbers multiply to be this and add to be this, right? Negative 7 and positive 1. Agreed?
Yeah.
And then now set those each equal to 0, you get 7 and negative 1.
Yeah.
Those are two x-intercepts. So one x-intercept is 7, 0. The other one is negative 1, 0. How do you get the y-intercept? You plug 0 into the function. Plug 0 in there, and what do you get? Negative 7. So this is another point, 0, negative 7. And now we're ready for a sketch. So when we do our sketch, and this is our final sketch, right? So when we do our final sketch, we kind of keep in mind these points. Let's see, I need to go, what, 7, negative 1, here negative 7, here look, 3, negative 16. So I need at least 16 units down. So maybe I'll do something like this. So put the vertex first. 1, 2, 3, there's 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, whatever, right?
Yeah.
And then right here. So that's the point 3, negative 16. And then just start putting your other points. Negative 1, 0. Is right here. 7, 0 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's 7, 0. And then we have the y-intercept of 0, negative 7. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's 0, negative 7. I would normally label all these points. Right, like that. And at this point, you can even do the axis of symmetry if you want. Have a ruler. What's the axis of symmetry? What is it on my picture? It's 3, right? But what is it? What am I about to draw? A vertical line? It's a dotted line. Is this actually part of our graph or no?
No.
It's not part of our graph. It's just to help us see what this thing's supposed to look like, right? All right, it's supposed to be like a mirror image over that. And then I'm going to draw a U, right? Not a V, not a straight line, a U. It's got to be curved down here. It's got to go up through that point and then through that point, and then pretty much do the same thing on this side. So that's good enough. Step 7 is to list out the domain, the range, and the axis of symmetry. So what is a domain? Yep, negative infinity to infinity. That's always the answer for domain on parabolas. So domain, is negative infinity to infinity. What about the range? Yeah, these are the y values. Good. So we look at the y values. The lowest y value we have is negative 16. And then it goes up forever, right? So we go negative 16 with a bracket on it to infinity, in a parenthesis on infinity. And then the axis of symmetry. Is x equals 3. That's it. That's what we're looking for. Yes?
If we don't do the dotted line for axis of symmetry, is that fine?
Yeah, you don't have to draw the dotted line.
Okay, I'm just making sure.
Okay, questions over homework? Did you have a question over homework? Which one were you looking at there? Okay, yeah, good one. Yep. All right, this one, y equals 3x squared minus 5. So let me first point out that this is a quadratic function that's missing the x term, right? There's an x squared term, but there's no x term. So if I were to be asked right now, what's a, b, and c? What's a, what's b, and what's c? What would you tell me? What's a? A is the number in front of x squared, right? Remember the formula, right? Ax squared plus bx plus c, right? That's our general formula for quadratic. So a for us here would be 3, right? What's b for us?
0.
There is no x, right? So you put 0 here, and then c would be negative 5. Okay? Understand? All right. Let's just keep that in mind. Now, let's go through the process. What is the up and down behavior here? What does this one do? Okay, it's going to go up. It's going up because this A is positive, right? I actually haven't even done one that goes down yet, but we'll do some of those today. Part 2, what's part 2? 2 is the vertex, right? And this one's kind of weird. Because h is equal to negative b over 2a, right? That's the formula we use. But negative b means negative 0. And negative 0 is just 0, right? And over 2 times 3, which is just 0, right? 0 divided by 6 is still 0. All right? To get k, we plug 0 in, right? We plug that answer into the function. And when we do that, we get negative 5, right? So this is the point 0, negative 5. Good so far? Okay. The next step is a quick sketch. And our quick sketch here is, 0, negative 5 just means down here, right? That's 0, negative 5? And then it goes up, so I'm actually going to have two x-intercepts again. All right, so how do we find these x-intercepts? Set the function equal to 0. And you got to go back now. You could use the quadratic formula here. Okay, you could. But do you remember when I said, I put up on the board when we were solving quadratics that there was like three cases?
Yes.
There's a case where the x is missing, the case where the number is missing, and the case where all of them are there. And this is the case where the x is missing. And this is where we use the square root property. So what we did was we would move this 5 to the other side by adding it to both sides. So if you add 5 here and add 5 here, you get 3x squared equals 5. Now we have another step. What do we do next? Divide by 3. Okay. So I'm going to get x squared equals 5 divided by 3. And then one more step. Square root both sides. And this is the one with the children on the bus, right? Plus or minus square root of 5/3. Calculator time. Understand?
Yeah.
Okay, so do square root of 5/3 on your calculator. And let's get this as a decimal. You get 1.29? Okay. And you'll have plus or minus. So plus or minus 1.29. Right? Two numbers. That's it. Did anybody do this with the quadratic, or would you have preferred to try the quadratic formula, or do you want to see the quadratic formula, or do you don't care?
I want to see it.
You want to see it?
No,
you don't. No, you don't. Okay. I'll do it. It's not hard. Negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times a times c over 2 times a. There. That's gone. That's gone. This right here, 20, that's 20 times 3 is 60. 60?
Yes.
Or 6. So when you're done here, you're going to get a root, I believe, 60 over 6, and then you could simplify this out, and this would come out, take something out here, 5, 12, yeah, anyway, it would simplify it. If you could do that in your calculator, it's the same answer, and plus or minus. Okay, x-intercept's done. What's next?
Y-intercepts.
So for the y-intercept, this is step 5. What's the y-intercept? Well, you plug in 0 to the function, right? And you get negative 5. Be careful. When you plug in 0 here, this is still here. The minus 5 is still there. So we have the point 0, negative 5. Does that point look familiar?
Yeah.
It's also your vertex, isn't it?
Yeah.
But it also is your y-intercept.
Yeah.
And now we're ready for our sketch. So let's do the sketch for 6. I need to go negative 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's negative 5. Put my vertex there. It's going to open up. I have x-intercepts of 1.29 and negative 1.29. So if this is 1 and this is 2, this is negative 1 and this is negative 2, 1.29, I don't know, it's about here. We don't have to be perfect. And then over here, right there, like that. Make sense? 1.29, negative 1.29. And then we need we got our x-intercepts. Our y-intercept, we said, was the same as the vertex. Our axis of symmetry is actually the y-axis, isn't it? Which is x is 0. But I'm just going to draw my little u here now, like that. And I'm done. I didn't, because it was a homework, I would label the points. Domain is everything. What's range?
Negative 5
to infinity. And then axis of symmetry is x equals 0. That makes sense? Okay. All right. Good? Anything else? We're going to do some word problems.
No.
Yes. Aren't you excited? But I need this cloth to be a little wet, so I'll be right back. So I would like to see if someone would be willing to loan me a textbook. Does anybody have a textbook with them? I need kind of like a textbook, like an actual textbook. Softback. Anyone have like a hardback? Thick. I'm gonna drop it, so I don't wanna. Let me see what you have. No, it's nobody has a hardback. Okay, let me borrow yours. All right. Okay. All right. So here's the deal. I have now. This is. I always tell you about random useless information. This is not random useless information. This is actually part of the class. Okay, but it's a demonstration. All right. So let's say that. I have this book here, obviously.
What's wrong with my book?
No, it's a good book.
It's a good book.
And then I have a piece of paper, and I'm going to drop the two. So which is going to hit the ground first?
The book?
The book?
No, the paper.
Or the paper?
Everyone's saying
take a vote.
Isn't it a theory?
You have an opinion?
You
have no opinion? Which one's going to hit first when I drop it? The book? Why?
Because
it's heavier? What do y'all think? Book? Everyone agree? There it goes. Okay. So did y'all see it? The book hit first?
Yes.
Okay. And the question is why?
Because
it's heavier. That's incorrect. It has nothing to do with how heavy it is.
Gravity
is the same. Gravity doesn't change. The atmosphere? What do you mean the atmosphere? Okay, so look, let's try and convince everyone that it has nothing to do with the weight. Do you think I can convince you that it has nothing to do with the weight? Let me see if I can. All right, so let's say I put this paper on top of this book, and there's no glue, there's no tape. I'm going to put this right on here. If you believe that the book drops faster because it's heavier, if that's what you believe, then what should happen here is that the book should start dropping, and because it's heavier, it's going to go faster than the paper, and so it should get ahead of the paper, shouldn't it? Just like it did when I put them like this. The book gets ahead, right, of the paper. So if I put this on top and do it, your theory of heavier should be this scenario. Do you agree with that? Okay.
Friction.
Okay, so they both went together, didn't they? And like I said, there's no tape here, there's no glue, all right? So there's nothing holding this, there's nothing holding it. If I try, I can't, even if I force it, I can't get it to, that's weird, right? Okay, so it has, thank you. It has nothing to do with how heavy something is. And this would be the same, you know, if you jump off a building or, and a rabbit jumps off a building next to you, right? It's a good day, right? You both jump off a building. And then you should both get there at the same time, but that's not what happens, just like the paper and the book. So what's happening is the air, okay? Air has the impact. So Have you ever been driving down the road? I know everyone has done this because it's super fun, super cool. You're driving down the road, roll down the window, put your hand out, you start doing that thing like that. Come on, who's never done that? You've never done that? You're missing out on a big part of life right now. You got to be like at least 50 miles an hour. Put your hand out there and just go like this. It's just fun. Right? Am I right? Okay. So what's happening there? The air's hitting you, right? So you put your hand out there, you're going to feel that air, right? When I'm just moving, walking around, I don't really feel it. So it's here. And when this is dropping, when the book and the air are dropping, that air resistance has a larger impact on the paper than it does the book. If we could somehow take the air out of the room, which is called a vacuum, when you suck all the air out of something, it's a vacuum. If you were to drop the two together, they would drop exactly, side by side, exactly the same time. In fact, for a long time, people didn't believe that this was true. Okay, so there's always been this like debate back and forth between science and religion. I don't know if y'all know this, but like, some religions used to preach that the earth was the center of the universe for a very, very long time. They believed that the earth was the center and everything went around the earth. And some scientists were like, no, we think it may not be that way. And what happened to them? They were put in prison for saying that, you know, that was true. Or they used to believe that the earth was flat, right? Well, they used to think that things dropped like that because it was heavier. That's what they used to think. Scientists said, no, we think it's the air. So the moon, okay, here's the moon. The earth is huge, right, compared to the moon. Here's the earth, right, here's the earth. I know the moon's not that close, but just perspective-wise, the moon's pretty small. And because of that, the moon does not have an atmosphere. You know, the air that we breathe every day is just the layer that goes around the earth, right? It's held to us because of gravity. And the gravity is because we're such a big planet. The moon's gravity isn't strong enough to keep an atmosphere in, so there's no air, right? So when we actually sent astronauts to the moon, one of the things that they did when they got out there is, you've seen the pictures of the guys like in the big old outfits, you know?
Yeah.
And they're like bouncing around on the moon, right? They're bouncing because the gravity is one third of what it is on Earth. So like if you weighed 150 pounds, here, then on the moon, you'll be like 50 pounds. It's either one third or two thirds. I can't remember. But what they did is they went out there, had a hammer in one hand and a feather in the other hand, and they dropped them, and they both went to the ground at the same time. They videotaped it. And the reason they did it was just kind of like a final, like, yeah, we told you. You know, like, we had known this as scientists. They knew it already, that it had nothing to do with how heavy it was. It was all about the air. That was just like a final, like, I don't know. You know what I'm saying? So if everything on Earth falls at the same rate, regardless of what it is, except for air. Now, we, you know, that's the big kind of, you know, if there's no air, everything should drop together, right? But if there is air, it's going to be a little bit different. If we just take out air for just a moment, and try and figure out, is there a way to predict how far something will fall, we wind up with this. And you're going to look at that and probably like get sick when you see it. Okay? But let me explain what this is. This is a quadratic function. All right? Please notice T appears here. And that looks very much like this right here. F of x equals ax squared plus bx plus c. Do you see for this function, we have x here? And over here, instead of calling the function f, we're calling it d. So our variable in the problem, or the variable in this equation, is t. Do y'all see that? Then here we had a number in front of x squared. What's the number in front of t squared here? Negative 16, all right? What's the number in front of x here is b. What's that number in front here? V with this little zero down there, right? I'll explain what all these things mean in a second. And then the last piece instead of c is this d with this little zero. This equation right here is what we use on this planet in order to predict where something is if you drop it. Okay, so this right here is what we call the falling body formula. And I don't mean like a body, like a human body, okay? It's a falling body or a falling object formula. If you're on Earth, you drop something, this right here will tell you where it is after a certain amount of time. Now, we have to say without air. And you're gonna sit there and go, wait a minute, why would you wanna have a formula that talks about what would happen if there was no air? And the reason is because it's kind of like you have to learn how to crawl before you walk, right? And you learn how to walk before you run. In a physics class, we teach this formula first without the air, and then we add the air later and it becomes a more complicated formula. All right, but we have to start with the basics. All right, let me explain what all these pieces are. But do you see that it really is just a quadratic function? Okay, so that means things fall quadratically in some way. It almost, like I had shown you when we were throwing the marker the other day, that things are parabolas on Earth. This is the formula that actually gives you the parabola. All right, so let me explain what all the things are here. T is time in seconds. Okay, so this formula is only going to work if your measurement of time is in seconds. V sub zero, okay, and the way we the way that we actually write or say that is V naught. But that is your initial. What's that? Is that a what?
I was wondering how you were spelling not.
I think it was N-A-U-G-H-T, something
okay,
like that.
U, okay.
Yeah. Initial speed. It's positive if up and negative if down. Now, I'd like to explain what I mean by this, all right? Because this is kind of a weird thing for students. Let's say I have two markers and I drop them at the same time, what's gonna happen? Should one of them drop faster? Should they drop the same? They should drop the same, right? So if I drop them, boom, they hit the ground same exact time. Now, what would happen if instead of dropping the blue one and the green one at the same time, I actually kind of threw the blue one and dropped the green one? Which one should get there first? The blue one got there first, right? I gave it an initial speed. So it actually got to the ground faster. What if I take the blue one, I'm gonna drop the green one, take the blue one and throw it up a little bit first. Which one's gonna get there first?
The green one,
right? So we want to account for that. And in our formula, the V naught, that number that's in front here, which used to be the B, right? It's the B that was in front of X. That number controls that initial speed. And then finally, D naught, what do you think D naught is? It's a distance. It's the initial height of the object. And this is measured in feet. So that means, you know, when I'm looking at this blue marker, I measure its height from the ground to here. You know, if it's 5 feet, then that number would be a 5. All right? Or if it's 30 feet high, then it would be a 30. Understand? The ground is zero. And then anything above would give you your initial height. And then the very last thing is, what does the function give you? D of t gives you the height of object at time t. So in order to know where an object is after a certain amount of time, if you drop it on Earth, then you need to know two things. How high was it when you let it go? And did you let it go, or did you just drop it, or did you throw it up a little bit or throw it down a little bit? Like, those two things, you give me those, and I can tell you exactly how high the object is after any point in time. All right? Make sense, kind of? We'll have to see it in action, but this negative 16 never changes, ever changes, unless you're on a different planet. If you're on a different planet, which some of you, I would argue, might be on a different planet, then your gravity is going to change, right? But if you're on Earth, you can make sure that's going to be the same. All right? So let's do our first example. All the homework examples that you'll see, most of the problems that you'll be doing, they actually give you this formula straight away. They tell you what this number is and tell you what that number is, and then they ask you some questions. That's the way they do it in the homework. My first example, I want it to be a little more inspired, so I'm going to actually not give you the formula right away, and I'm going to ask us to come up with it. All right. So, should I talk about this or not? I don't know. Can y'all handle this?
Yeah.
I want to talk about 9/11 a little bit. Can y'all handle that?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
All right, so 9/11. The reason I bring this up is because like a year or two after, I think it was like the year after 9/11 in my college algebra class, there was a problem in the book where it was saying, it was trying to figure out how long it would take a penny to hit the ground if it was dropped off the World Trade Center. But this was like a year or two after the 9/11 attacks, but it was still in the textbook. And so we actually had to have this very like kind of weird, surreal talk about like the World Trade Center that wasn't there anymore. And anyway, we got to the discussion, and we all know that on that day, some people had to choose a fate of actually going out the building, right? Burn to death, jump off of a 120-story building. What's your choice, right? Okay, so we're going to look at this mathematically, which is why I hope you can handle this. You had the World Trade Center was approximately, we're just going to go with the rough number of 1,200 feet. It's 120 stories, roughly 10 feet per story, let's just say. We're just going to go with that rough number. It might be a little over, it might be a little under, who cares? That's high enough, right? Okay, my question is, how long would it take an object to return to ground zero, okay, the level ground, if it was dropped off the top of that building? In other words, how long is that fall, right? That's what I'm asking? All right, so help me out. What do I know? I mean, go back to this formula. I said there were two things you need to know, right? Okay, do you know the initial height? And I didn't tell you what initial meant. I assumed you did know what that meant. Initial means like starting. Okay, so what's the starting height of the object off this building? 1,200. So I know that this number right here is 1,200, right? So I'm going to even write that down. This really means D-naught. And I said you needed two things, D-naught and V-naught. V-naught is your initial velocity. So if someone were to jump off a building, we're going to say there's no initial velocity, that it's as good as them just dropping, right? Because you know what I'm saying? So it's like with the marker, right? We're just going to assume that they just dropped instead of like jumping up and out, which maybe that happened, or jumping down. Who knows, right? But let's just, for the sake of making this easy, let's just assume that it was just a straight drop. Got it? So that means V-naught would be what? I said it was positive if the object has an initial velocity upward, and negative if it's downward. So what's between positive and negative?
Zero.
Okay, so your V-naught would be zero. This just means it's just dropped. Okay? Anytime the object is just dropped, your V-naught's always going to be zero. And that generates, right there, those two pieces of information will generate the quadratic function that represents an object falling off a 1,200-story building. Right? Here it is. Right? That's it. This is 0. That's gone. That number is 1,200. There it is. This is the World Trade Center quadratic function. Now, graphically, I know we have one simple question here. How long did it take, right? But graphically, going back to what we're learning in here, what is this? It's a parabola, right? Which way does it open? Downward, right? So if it opens down, I know that my graph is going to look something like that, right? So I could go through the whole process of sketching this right now, couldn't I? And I'm going to do that just to practice it, that's all. Let's just practice sketching this. What would the first thing be if I were being asked to sketch this? Up or down, right? So it goes down. Why does it go down? Because it's negative in front, right? Okay, so next step, vertex. So how do you get the vertex? H is negative B over 2A. So I want you again to treat this like A, B, C. Remember our variable is T, not X though. T for time. So this would be negative, what's B?
Zero.
Zero, right? We don't have a T term to this. Over 2 times negative 16, it doesn't matter, does it? It's still 0. And then your k is what you get when you plug 0 in this. So k would be f of 0. Actually, I should say d of 0. Because our function's d, not f. And this would be 1,200. OK? Following me?
Yeah.
All right, now. Quick sketch is next. My vertex is up here at 0, 1,200, way up there, and it opens down. So how many x-intercepts am I going to have?
Two
of them. So now let's go find them. And I'm still going to call these x-intercepts, even though technically these are t-intercepts. Because t is our variable, these should be called t-intercepts, but I'm going to leave them as x. So what are you going to do to find these? Set the thing equal to 0, right? Set this function to 0. And how do you go about solving this particular quadratic equation? Which of the three cases is this one? You're missing like the x, aren't you? And how do we do this when we're missing, like, the x thing in there? We're missing t, actually, right? But, right?
Square root property.
So we're going to move the 1,200 over. Divide both sides by negative 16. So take 1,200 divide by, or negative 1,200 divide by negative 16, and you should get, oh, nice number, right? T squared is 75. And then square root. So square root, and let's do it as a decimal. What do you get? T is plus or minus, very good, 8.66. 8.66. All right, y-intercept. Plug in 0, which we actually did when we were doing the vertex. So we already know that this is going to be 1,200 again, right? And now we graph. Now we graph. Are y'all following me?
Yes.
It's all right? Okay. So here's our graph. Now, 1,200, I guess I'm going to have to count by like 200s or something. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. So there's 1,200. Right, there's 200. Is that okay with you, counting by 200s? My vertex is right here. Where are my x or t intercepts? 8.6, right? Negative 8.6. So I'm going to count on this axis. Let me count these by ones. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There's 8. So 8.6. I don't know. Again, ballpark. Good enough?
Yeah.
And then I have one negative. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There's negative 8, and then a little more. So close enough. And then I draw my parabola, right? My y-intercept, I already have it. So y'all right with this?
Yeah.
Okay. So when I go and I draw this and I'm done like this, that should be a picture of what's happening. Now, let's talk about domain for a second, because it's not what it's always been. This graph represents how high this object was, right? This is the height. So this is height. And this over here is time, right? Time was measured in seconds. And this was height in feet. So at time equals zero, the object was 1,200 feet high, right? And as time went on, the height of the object was going down, right? So when you say domain, does it make sense for us to talk about anything over here? Why or why not? This is negative time, right? And our word problem does not include negative time. We are saying if an object is dropped, as soon as it starts dropping, right, from that moment, how long does it take for it to hit the ground? So really, for this particular word problem, the domain of this in the graph of this is only this stuff in red. It doesn't even go past this, and it doesn't come over here. Does that make sense? So what would the domain in this particular word problem be? 0 to 8.66, right? Domain would be our graph this way. It does not exist over here, and it doesn't exist down here. So domain would be, you said 0 to 8.66. And then the range, you start from the bottom and go up. So what was the range? What's the lowest point? Zero, highest point?
1,200.
Now that's a very, very crude breakdown of something falling off the World Trade Center. Now can you answer the question?
Yes.
How long did it take to hit the ground?
8.6
seconds, right? Now that's without air. That's what would have happened without air. What would air have done? Would it have sped it up or slowed it down? Would have actually slowed down the process. So it would have been a little slower. And I've always found it very troubling yet amazing that if, you know, like every year around September 11th, there's always like some History Channel documentary. That's all you see. And no matter what you do, if you're watching any TV, at some point you're going to see the towers falling somewhere on TV. Okay, so if you actually go back and have the nerve to watch it again, if you time it, it actually takes longer than 8 seconds. So when you watch it, doesn't it seem like it just like took forever for that thing to come down? Well, that's because it took like 8 seconds. Like, think about how long that is, right? That's a long fall, right? 8 seconds. So, but it's not much longer than 8 seconds, which to me has always been very, I guess, amazing. Because when the towers fell, it actually had to, each time, it had to crush each floor below it as it came down. And we're talking a tremendous amount of energy in order to do that. I mean, if you've ever seen like a steel beam, these beams that hold up buildings, the fact that they had to like demolish those beams each story, I mean, that energy that was released in that collapse was just so much energy that it didn't even slow it down. It still maintained what it was supposed to do as if it was in free fall. Y'all get what I'm saying? It's like if you get an aluminum can, you try and crush it, it's going to resist you crushing it, right? Well, that building did not do anything to slow down gravity from pulling it down, almost as if it was in free fall. So that's why everything got turned to dust. It was just a lot of energy. Okay, that was morbid. I told you it would be. But I think this problem is a little more interesting than if I were to say, like, hey, we're going to throw a rock off a cliff. You know? It's like, who cares? Now, this is not off topic, not random useless information, but there is, believe it or not, from calculus, there's another formula. There's a formula from calculus. Guess, I'm going to write it up here. You try and guess what this formula is. It's connected to this. All right. Take a look at that. What do you think that this means, this formula gives you?
Velocity.
It actually gives you, if you drop an object on Earth and you let it go, this formula gives you how fast it was is going after a certain amount of time. All right? So let's look at this, because this, believe it or not, will tie into something we've done before. If we just jump off this building, right, it's going to take us 8.6 seconds to get to the ground. This formula tells us how fast we are after a certain amount of time. So what if we just jump off the building, what's our initial velocity?
Zero.
We did that already. That's zero, so that's gone. Okay, time it took was 8.6. So I'm going to take my calculator, and I'm going to take negative 32, and multiply that times 8.66. And I'm going to get a velocity of negative 277. Now this is measured in feet per second. Anybody know how fast negative 277 feet per second is? Is that fast? Is that slow?
Slow.
All right. Well, you know how to do this. We've done this before. How do you convert? Let's just do positive 277 feet per second into miles per hour. So how many feet are in a mile? 5,280 feet in 1 mile. And how many seconds are in an hour? 60 are in a minute.
60 seconds.
3,600 seconds in 1 minute. We've done this already. I'm just kind of throwing it up here real fast because I want to give you an answer, because I think that this is kind of amazing. 277 times 3,600 divided by 5,280. It's approximately 188 miles per hour. What do you think about that? That's fast. It actually turns out that if you jump out of an airplane or a building, off a large building, if you're allowed to speed up and speed up, you'll hit what's called terminal velocity. And for most human beings, it's about 120 miles an hour. So like you can't go any faster than 120 miles an hour. So most of the people that chose to jump off the building that day hit terminal velocity of about 120 miles an hour. If there were no air, they would have got up to that speed. So again, depressing, but that's the reality. Okay, so let's do a problem that's a little more cheery. And this will be our word problems here. All right, I'm going to work off of page, this is page 74. There's a word problem here. They give you the following quadratic function: h of t equals negative 16 t squared. That look familiar? Plus 128 t. All right, here's what it says. The height h in feet of a small rocket t seconds after it is launched is shown. The path of the rocket is given by this equation. First question: how long is it in the air? That's the first question. So let's try and look at the graph real quick, because they give you the graph in the problem. It goes like this. That's the graph. How long is it in the air is the first question. What are they asking for here? How long is it in the air? No idea? Remember, this is time. This is your height. This is an object on Earth, right? Okay. How long is it in the air? So they launch the rocket, right? Here's time is zero. They launch the rocket, it starts going up. Time is going by, goes up, hits its top, and it comes down, and it hits here, right? This point right here would be how long it was in the air, right? The distance from here to here. So what do they really want here? They want you to find the x-intercepts, right? That's what they want, but they want the one on the right side. So how would you do that? Yes, you could look at the graph, but you're not going to get a great answer. Well, it might be good enough. How would you do it if all you had was this without the graph? Anyone? Okay, you're going to set that equal to zero, right? And then you're either going to, it's going to be either case one, two, or three. So you're going to be setting this quadratic to zero and solving. Yes? I'm not going to do the work. I'm asking you if you know what you would need to do here. Okay, second question is, what is the greatest height of the rocket? What is the maximum height of the rocket? Okay, good. I heard vertex. I'm going to semi-agree with you. Because the vertex gives you both an H and a K, right? Yes? So when they say what's the maximum height, does everyone agree that the maximum height is that number? Now, this number down here is when it happens, right? The time. This is the time it happens. This is the actual height itself. So if this is the point HK, then what is that number two actually asking you for? H or K?
K.
They want K. Understand? You want K to get this. And we have a formula to get K, right? You have to get H first, then you can get K. Okay. All right, next question. About how high is the rocket after 1 second? How high is rocket after 1 second? What are they asking for here? Yeah, plug one, because one is time, right? I mean, one second is time. Plug one into this function. So they want H of one. Again, I'm not working through any of these. I'm just showing you what the setup is. One goes in here, so plug one in here, plug one in there, work it out, and then whatever that answer is, that's going to tell you how high you are. With me? Okay, the next one. I should have been labeling these. These are actually, on the page, it's labeled A, B, C, D, but I'm going to leave this. Okay, it says, at two seconds, here's the questions. How high is the rocket? And then the second question is it going up or down? So how could we figure out the first one? How high is it? Yeah, couldn't we just plug in 2 into the function again? But we could also look at the graph. And do you see that at 2, they have, you may not have this with you. So at 2, they actually give you a point, and you can kind of tell what it is, all right? And from that graph, we can answer the next question. Is it going up or down? So at 2, we're here, it's still going up as time goes on. So it's going up. Then they ask you the same two questions for at time is equal to 6. And 6 is over here. And the last question is, what's the domain and range? So 0 to, well, you have to answer that first question. How long was it in the air, right? So you have to get that x-intercept. That'd be your domain. And the range would be from 0 to, well, however, whatever k was. All the homework problems are like this. There's a word problem. They give you a function. They ask you a bunch of questions. You think you can try those? Come back with questions on Wednesday? Okay, so if your homework is page 77. And 78. There's five questions. So see how you do with those. Let me see. It's 11. I haven't taken attendance in a while, so I'm going to need to. I apologize. Oh, wait, hold on. Anybody not take the quiz? Did you not turn anything in? No? Okay, so what was your last name? C? What? Oh, okay, got you. I thought I heard a K in there. What's your last name? Okay, I want to count y'all as being here, but I'm going to take it off of this. Okay, we good? Everyone have a good day?